Welcome back for another week. Caught a really pretty fall week here. Great weather. Great to see everyone out today for the seventh installment of our Romans series. And it's just a beautiful day. I hate to take everyone away from the coffee time. It's such a great time in the fellowship. Let me encourage you and let you know that you can get here as early as you want. Well, actually, not technically as early as you want. But you can get here a lot earlier than you might otherwise get if you want to enjoy coffee and fellowship, so we certainly encourage that. So sorry to interrupt that time, but we'll go ahead and get things cranked up. As you're getting settled, one of the things I mentioned a while ago is that every now and then I'm going to throw a little introductory tidbit out to you about Reformed Theological Seminary, just a chance for you to get to know us better. We're getting to know you. We want you to get to know us. And so today I just throw out another little factoid. A few weeks ago, I threw out the factoid that a lot of our grads are all over the world. Today, I throw out another factoid you may not know, and some of you may know, and that is that Reformed Theological Seminary is a non-denominational seminary. Now, some of you may know that, some of you may not, but when RTS was started in 1966, we had this idea that we wanted to serve a big, broad range of evangelical schools and evangelical churches, and so we had no particular denominational affiliation. You'll know that a lot of seminaries are just connected with one denomination. RTS decided that we're going to be non-denominational. And right now on the Charlotte campus, we have over 40 different denominations represented in our student body, which is really exciting. We got folks from all over the place and all kinds of different churches serving Christ. And that's exactly what our vision was intended to be. You may know, though, and this is the other little tidbit about us, even though we're denominational, RTS is also confessional, and this is what makes us unique. Even though we don't serve a particular denomination, we do have a very particular commitment confessionally to what's called the Westminster Confession of Faith, which is a historic document from the 1600s. I know that sounds like a long time ago, but we intentionally decided that when we started the seminary, we didn't want to just sort of pretend like we're starting something new that no one's thought of before. So the idea was we wanted to root our teaching in a real historic document called the Westminster Confession of Faith. You can look it up and read about it. It's a wonderful document that really outlines what Christians have believed for generations. And by the way, this is why we're called Reformed Theological Seminary, because that confession comes out of the Reformation, Reformed. And so if you're wondering, why do they call it Reformed Theological Seminary? The answer is because we hold to a confession of faith that was born in the 17th century out of the Protestant Reformation in Europe, and that was really what our identity is. And so we're non-denominational. We are confessional. We do have a really robust commitment to that particular vision theologically. We think that's a great combination for how to do a seminary. Some of you who are in my denomination, the Presbyterian Church in America, the PCA, you may not know that the PCA asked RTS to be its denominational seminary a long time ago, back in the 70s when the denomination was just started. And RTS thought about it and then said, you know, we're going to stick with our original plan and stay non-denominational. So there's a little tidbit for you, just to get to know us better as we get to know you better. But welcome to the Bible study. It's great to see you all again. We are pressing our way through the book of Romans, and today we are in chapter 2. You're thinking, man, that took a while, right? But I'm gonna break a new record today. Today we're going to cover more verses in one time than we ever have yet. We're going to cover 11 whole verses. Can you imagine? So I know it's a daunting task. I probably won't get through it. But we are going to take chapter 2, believe it or not, in two entire chunks. So we're going to cover all of chapter 2 in two studies. So this week and next week, and we'll be done with chapter 2. Not because I don't like chapter 2, but just the way it breaks down, it just fits better to do it in larger chunks. And you'll see that'll happen from time to time in the book of Romans. There'll be ebbs and flows and so on. So where are we in this study? Let me just catch us up. You'll recall that we've been learning from the very beginning that Paul's major thesis is both simple but wonderful news, that we're saved not by our own merits, our own works, but through faith alone, not just faith generally, but faith in Christ alone. That's how we're saved, not by what we do. And there's a reason for that, Paul says, and he's building his case, you remember, and his case is very sort of nerve-wracking at one level, but also very enlivening at another level. And he says, you know why you can't save yourself? It's because you're a sinful person. In fact, God is very disposed against sin, and we talked about God's wrath in the last couple classes, and because of that, you can't just work your way to heaven. You have to actually be forgiven through Christ. And so Paul's going to labor through three chapters almost to show how all the world is guilty under sin and therefore needs salvation in Christ. And he begins that in chapter 1, and he continues it here in chapter 2. But here's what's happening now. At the end of chapter 1, You'll recall that Paul said, you know all those Gentiles out there, out living who knows where on some desert island or in some other country that may never have heard about the God of Israel? Yes, they're guilty too. And here's all the things they're guilty of. They knew God and suppressed it, and they engaged in all these activities and so on. And Paul went quite at length in that argument. And then you can imagine this little cheering section in the background of people saying, you go get them, Paul. Yeah, you're right. Finally someone says what needs to be said about those Gentiles out there, right? Wholeheartedly in agreement, right? Rah, rah, Paul. And then Paul, in chapter 2, which starts today, says, you know something? I'm not just talking about those Gentiles out there. I'm also talking about you who just cheered on what I just said. See, here's what Paul's going to do today. He's going to leave the world of the people out there, and he's going to shift to religious people, which in Paul's day were just Israel, right? And he's going to say, you know something? All you Israelites who are cheering me on as I go after the Gentiles, guess what? You stand under exactly the same judgment as they do. And here's where you could hear a pin drop if Paul were saying this to a group. The people would say, what? The Israelites are under the same judgment as everybody out there? No, that can't be. We're in a special category. We're different than everybody else. You don't understand, Paul. You don't get it. And Paul goes, no, I get it. You're the one that doesn't get it. And so now I'm going to prove my case to you that you likewise stand under God's judgment and that you need to trust in Christ too, not just for them, but for everybody. So this is where Paul is going to take us today. It's a very challenging text. You know why? Because some of us may have been here last week and thought, yeah, I'm not like those bad people out there. I'm religious. And Paul says, you know something? Religious people need the gospel too. In fact, religious people, in some strange sense, may need it more. And that's exactly where we're going to go today in this study. So take a look at your outline there. You have it on your tables. You know the routine by now. You got the little hole punch. You can stick it in your notebook. Notice the title, which I just said at the very top of the page, Romans 2, 1 through 11. Yes, religious people need the gospel too. And that will be our theme today. So let's read this passage, and then I'll open us in a word of prayer. Starting at the beginning of Romans chapter 2, verse 1, I'll read us through these very long 11 verses, right? Verse 1. Therefore, you have no excuse, O man, every one of you who judges, for in passing judgment on another, you condemn yourself, because you, the judge, practice the very same things. We know that the judgment of God rightly falls on those who practice such things. Do you suppose, O man, you who judge those who practice such things and yet do them yourself, that you will escape the judgment of God? Or do you presume on the riches of his kindness and forbearance and patience, not knowing that God's kindness is meant to lead you to repentance? But because of your hard and impenitent heart, you are storing up wrath for yourself on the day of wrath when God's righteous judgment will be revealed. He will render to each one according to his works. To those who by patience and well-doing seek for glory and honor and immortality, he will give eternal life. But for those who are self-seeking and do not obey the truth but obey unrighteousness, there will be wrath and fury. There will be tribulation and distress for every human being who does evil, the Jew first and also the Greek. But glory and honor and peace for everyone who does good, the Jew first and also the Greek, for God shows no partiality. It's a lot to take in. You may have thought after chapter 1, okay, we're done with all that, right? Paul's not done. He's got more for us today. So let's pray and ask God to bless this text to us. Lord, we hear your word and confess that it's a lot to take in. But Lord, we know you speak truth. Give us encouragement and even conviction if necessary today from what you have to say here, we pray in Christ's name. Amen. All right, take a look at your outline. We're going to talk about religious people today, which I would imagine, since all of you are in a Bible study, this includes you, right? And me, I'm teaching a Bible study, so we would all be considered religious people. But in Paul's context, he's really talking about the Israelites of his day. But look at your outline. I want you to see that Paul is going to address whether the same judgment applies to religious people as non-religious people. And Paul's going to make his case here. In Roman number 1, I'm going to talk about how he shifts his attention to them. And then Roman number 2, religious people falsely assume they're in good standing with God. And then Roman number 3, particularly, religious people who don't trust in Christ are still under God's same judgment. So this is where we're headed today. And let's start with Roman number 1 there, Paul's shift of attention. Here's what happens transitioning from Romans 1 to Romans 2. Most scholars recognize that Paul now is leaving the world of sort of the people out there, the Gentiles, and now he's talking to religious people. And what he really means in that context is people in his own day, Israelites, his fellow Jews. Remember, Paul was a Jew. He's talking to his fellow Jews, and we get this from a lot of different places. Later, Paul just blatantly makes it clear he's addressing Jews down in verse 17. But for now, we get this from a very obvious thing. He's talking about those who judge other people according to God's law. fact, look at verse 1 there. Therefore, you have no excuse, O man, every one of you who judges. Now, this isn't a reference to the Gentile out there. There's no doubt this is a reference to Paul's fellow Jewish individuals who are looking out at the Gentile audience, remember, and cheering Paul on the point he just made. And Paul is now shifting his attention to those religious people and saying, look, even though you're religious, even though you're Israelite, even though you're busy with all these religious things, guess what? The same message that God is displeased with sin and you need to be saved by grace, that applies to you too. So I want you to notice that Paul is shifting things here in a way that's unexpected in our world. You know, we talked about a little bit last week, our world thinks that the gospel message or that the people who really need to be saved are the really bad people, right? And Paul's saying, well, guess what? Here's an interesting thing, is that when you say the religious people are okay and the really bad people need to be saved, Paul says it's even the religious people that need to be saved. And Paul does something stunning here. He makes a very interesting point. He says, you know, sometimes it's actually the outwardly religious people that are further from God than the blatantly immoral people. Why? Because they may think wrongly that they're doing just fine even when they're not. In fact, you could almost sum up this shift towards religious people by a parable that Jesus told. And you know it well. It's actually one of my favorite parables. It's the parable of the Pharisee and the tax collector that Jesus told. That parable makes the same point that Paul's going to make in this whole passage. You remember the parable. Jesus says two men walk into the temple, a Pharisee and a tax collector. And in that day, the Pharisee was probably lauded and praised as religious and right, and the tax collector was despised and hated because of the various things he engaged in. And it wasn't, by the way, just because he collected taxes. No one likes that, right? The tax collector was despised because he collaborated with the Roman government against Israel. He was hated. Two of these people walk into a temple, and one says, the Pharisee, thank God I'm not like other men. I'm certainly not like that tax collector over there. I give a tenth of all I get, and I do all these other wonderful things. Thank you, God, for having such a great person like me on your team, basically. Then the tax collector won't even look up to heaven. He's in the background, beating his chest, head bowed. He's not worried about the Pharisee, right? What is he thinking about? He says, God, have mercy on me, a sinner. And then Jesus says, which of those two men left the temple justified? And now you have to realize Jesus' original audience would have thought, everybody knows the Pharisee's in and the tax collector's out. And Jesus just shocks everybody and says, no, it's the opposite. Just because you're outwardly religious doesn't mean God's pleased with you. And here's the shocking thing that Paul wants you to see when he shifts the attention. He wants you to recognize that sometimes the people furthest from God, some of the times the people who are most under God's judgment can actually be people who are outwardly religious or spiritual or committed to religious things. Think about all of Paul's fellow Israelites. I mean, they had all the religious system you could ask for, and Paul's getting ready to tell you, you know what? That didn't make the difference. Just doing those outward things doesn't cut it. So Paul is introducing a new category here. That's what I want you to see under point one. This new category is not just that bad, those bad people out there, but he's saying people who seem to be religious, they still have the same problem. Because as we'll see, they're sinners too. So leaving that very brief first point, let's look at Roman numeral 2. And this is the main thing Paul's driving at here. Religious people falsely assume often that they're in good standing with God. Why is it that sometimes being religious doesn't always get you closer to heaven? Here's why. It's because sometimes, and I would say most of the time, people who are religious just assume naturally and inherently that I must be okay, right? God's pretty pleased with me. Think about that Pharisee in the parable of the Pharisee and the tax collector. He goes in and goes, God is lucky to have me on his team. Look at all the great things I do, right? I'm a pretty good guy, certainly not like that tax collector, and I'm doing all right. This is the classic American syndrome, by the way. And I would add to it, this is the classic Southern American syndrome, which is that, hey, I'm a pretty good person. I pay my taxes. I try to do my best to raise my kids. I'm working hard at a job. I'm not out doing those really bad things that Paul just listed in Romans 1, by the way, right? And instead, I'm just kind of just plugging away. Yeah, I'm not perfect. But hey, I'm doing my best. And when the day comes for God to let me into heaven, he's going to look at me and say, hey, you really did your best. You're a pretty good guy. I'm pretty happy with you. Come on into heaven. That narrative is the narrative for so many people in the South. And maybe even as you're hearing that today in your own mind, you're thinking, you know, truth be told, that's what I'm telling myself. If that's us at any level today, Paul has a very clear message for us. And he says, you know, unfortunately, that's just not how it works. Being religious is not enough. Being outwardly moral is not enough. And he's getting ready to tell us why. But here's the thing he wants you to realize, that some people live life deceived about this. They think they're okay with God, but they really aren't. In fact, I sit on, one of the things that always happens to me is I fly all these different places to do different things for the seminary and also to speak. And every time I'm on a plane, you sit down next to somebody, right? And what's the first thing they ask you? What do you do? And I'm like, okay, here we go, right? And every time I got to tell them, okay, I'm a professor and president of a seminary. And their first comeback is, you know, I go to church, you know? And I'm like, well, that's good, you know? Nothing wrong with that. And I realize they're trying to give me their resume, right? Hey, look, I'm a pretty good guy. So why is it that religious people think they're in good standing with God when they really may not be? Let's look at this point a little closer. Roman numeral 2. First, they assume they're good enough. Notice what Paul says here about the Jews. They judge other people's sin. Look down in verse 2 here. We know that the judgment of God rightly falls on those who practice such things. This is a Jewish maxim. God justly judges sin. And so you know what the Jews are doing? They're helping God do it. They're standing by God's side in their head. And they're like, look at all those awful people out there doing those sins. Yeah, you know, go after them, God. Go punish those sins. They deserve it, right? Because they, on one level, are right. God does punish sin. Okay, but notice all the while they're doing that, what are they assuming about themselves? They're assuming that God shouldn't punish me because I'm better than they are, right? I'm good enough. And here is the problem in Southern America is that people assume that they're inherently pretty good. And Paul's making a very profound point here. He goes, you know what people's standard is for whether they're good enough? And this is what the Jews were doing. Their standard is other people. And here's what I want you to see about what Paul's driving at in this point, is that if you go around and you point your finger at other people and say, because they're sinners and because God rightly judges them and because I'm on God's side calling it out, therefore God must be pleased with me, all that is simply arguing that God is pleased with me because I'm not as bad as they are. Or to put it yet another way, often we think we're good enough because the standard is just other people around us. Now, here's an honest question for you to answer today, and you need to answer. You can answer it rhetorically in your own head. Don't need to answer it out loud, but how often do you spend time comparing yourself to other people? Now, we do this in lots of ways in the Christian life. Sometimes we do it in an envious way. We compare ourselves to other people and say, I wish I had their life or their car or their house or what happens. That's not what I'm talking about here. How do you compare yourself to other people in terms of your own relationship with God? Do you say, I'm probably okay with God because I'm not as bad as that guy over there that sits in that cubicle at work? Or that other mother, and I see she's not very good at raising her kids. She's, you know, this, that, or the other. And we look at other people and we say, because I'm not as bad as them, therefore God has pleasure with me. Here's the point Paul wants to make here, is that when you think that you're in good standing with God just because you're better than the next person, you're missing a very profound point, and that is the next person isn't the standard. Just because you're better than another person, and some people are better than other people in terms of sort of absolute holiness, just because some people are more holy than others doesn't matter, because all of them fall so far short of God's holiness that it would be silly to think that just because you're better than somebody else that it matters. The analogy I sort of hinted at the other week is the Grand Canyon analogy. Your distance from God is like the Grand Canyon. Right? What if you tried to jump over the Grand Canyon? How far would you get? You know, they have those little railings right there to keep people from trying such things. What if someone says, you know, I can jump maybe 10 yards out there if you're really good. And maybe you could go further than the person next to you. So you say, let's have a test. So you both try to jump over the Grand Canyon, and he gets out 8 yards, and you get out 10 yards, and you think, ah, I won, as you plunge to your death into the Grand Canyon. What's the point? Both of you aren't going to cross, regardless if you're better than the person next to you. Here's the thing. The reason religious people are deceived by their own standing with God is because they assume they're good enough, and the only reason they do that is because the standard is somebody else. What if the standard were God? Or to put it another way, what if the standard were God's law, God's word, and God's holiness? Then would that be the conclusion? Paul's getting ready to drop the hammer on his fellow Israelites here by saying, you know something, the standard, and you know this, is actually God's holiness. And you also know that you have fallen very, very short of that holiness. There's a second reason, though, that religious people assume they're in good standing with God. It's not just because they assume they're good enough. Look at point B under that second Roman numeral. They also assume that God will show special kindness to them. I've got a special category that I'm in good with God in. Look at verse 4 of that. Notice what Paul says to them. Or do you presume? Notice the word. That's not a good word, presume, right? Paul is making a very clear case here to them. Or do you presume on the riches of his kindness and forbearance and patience? Here's what's going on. Paul knows, because he's an Israelite, Paul knows what his fellow Israelites are doing. They're thinking to themselves, First of all, I'm better than the Gentiles. Okay, so that's step one. Step two, God has a special little disposition towards me. He's specially kind to me. He's going to take it easy on me. He's got a little, I got a carved out category here for why God's going to give me extra patience. Yeah, I'm not perfect, but you know something? God's a patient guy. And he's not patient with them over there, of course, but he's going to be patient with me. And of course, even when you hear that reason, you're thinking, golly, that's amazingly audacious, right? To assume that you got the special category carved out for you. But this is what the Israelites had in their mind. They're thinking, we're Israel. We're God's chosen people. I'm part of the nation. You know, that they may say, look, I've been sort of brought into the covenant fold. Maybe I've been circumcised and I've got the sort of the sign of the mark of the covenant. I take part of the Passover meal. I'm part of the covenant people of God. Surely God looks at me with special favor. And yeah, even though I'm not perfect, God's going to overlook those little sins because they're just little. And then God has a special love for me anyway because I'm in this special little category. Paul's getting ready to say, you know, it doesn't work like that either. You know why? And he's going to say it later. God's judgment isn't based on what nation you're in or what your family is. It's based on absolute rule of holiness. In other words, it's without partiality at all. Now, this should hit home with us, shouldn't it? Why? Because, let's be honest, we all, in our own minds, carve out little niches in our own minds for why we think God's going to sort of take it easy on us, right? Why we're not like other people, because we have a special category. Or we know people in the world who do that, even if we don't. What are some of those categories that people rely on? Here's where I open it up for a few seconds. What are some categories that people rely on that give them a special assurance, in their own mind at least, that I'm okay with God because of X? Ideas behind this. Of course, we all live in the South here, so we probably got 100 of these, right? Yep, what would be an example?
Well, like the rich young ruler, he had a whole list of laws that he obeyed.
Right, so some people are going to say, well, look, I do a lot of good things. I serve at the soup kitchen, right? I help old ladies cross the street, right? Whatever list of things, I can list all these things up. But here's the problem with that, of course, even if you do all those good things, but that, does that overcome all the other things you're doing that aren't good? Does that still make up for those? And of course, Paul's point is it doesn't solve that. But that's something people rely on, is look at these good works I'm doing. Yep. Interesting, right? I had a hard life, or do have a hard life, therefore, God, you know, maybe he's mad at those people out there, but he could be mad at me because, in one sense, he owes me. I've had it hard, right? My husband lost his job. You know, we're in debt. Maybe it was even worse. Maybe there's some sort of illness in the family. You think, well, God owes me. Surely I'm not under this same category, Paul. So people could sort of put that category out. Yep.
I'm in the right club or the right political party.
Right. So I'm in the right social group, okay? It could be the right social circles. It could be political. But most often it's not that. Most often it's churches, right? Someone say, well, I go to church. I'm a member of X church. And if I'm a member of X church, then God must think that I'm in good standing, right? And of course, when you start really saying it like that, you're like, well, golly, no one really believes that. But they do, and that's the amazing thing. Ruth, can you give another example? Ah, yes. Yes. So if America is largely associated with being a Christian, and someone says, well, are you a Christian? And someone says, well, let's think for a moment. I'm in America, and my parents went to church, and so I sort of go on Easter and Christmas. So therefore, I must be an American-esque Christianized person, therefore. Yeah. Okay, so they maybe make a link to the nation of Israel. Right. Yep. Yes. Yeah. Yeah, yeah. Think about it for a moment. Someone rely on their own family members, right? Maybe your family members are pastors, or maybe your family members are just devout Christians. You think, those coattails, I'm going to ride those right into heaven, right? Now, we could go on and on here, and I'm sure the list is lengthy. But here's the point, is that we all in our own minds, says Paul, carve out these little categories. We just assume, you know, God's going to take it easy on me. He's got some special benevolence towards me because I'm unique. And Paul says, you know, it just doesn't work like that. Here's the reality. Not only are you not good enough, but also God is not going to be partial when he judges. He's not going to be partial to who your parents were or to what country you're born in or whether you're a Jew or a Gentile. And as we'll see later in just a moment, Paul's going to say, you know, God's judgment is absolutely by the facts. It's all based on the evidence. He's like a trial judge. He's like, you know, you claim you know the judge and I'm going to get off easy. And he's like, well, you know, even though I'm related to you, I'm judging it by the evidence. And this is basically what Israel had done. Israel had said, you don't realize, we know the judge. He's a buddy. He's a pal, right? And so when I get to that courtroom, yeah, it's not all right, but he's for me, okay? And what Paul's going to say is that that's not the way God judges. God doesn't say, oh, this is a family member. I'm going to take it easy on them, but then everyone else I'm going to judge according to the facts. No, he says God is going to do it on the bare bones evidence. And if it's on the bare bones evidence, everyone says, oh, no, right? Because if it's on the bare bones evidence, then none of us are going to stand. And that's, of course, Paul's point. You can't stand. You need Christ. You need the gospel. Look at the key points to sum up this point here that you can see at the bottom. First key point, religious people rely on their own goodness. That's one, which we talked about based on our comparison to other people. And two, God's benevolence. God has a special disposition towards me, right? He's a patient God, and he's especially patient to me. I'm in with the judge for salvation. That's what we rely on instead of Christ, and then we can regularly condemn bad behavior in others. This is the profound reality of religious people's disposition towards God. And Paul says, let's think about it for a moment. Who's further from God here? That pagan Gentile out there, or you Israelites? If you're deceived enough to think that you're in good standing with God when you're not just because you're religious, they might be in more danger. Very much the same story that Jesus gave about the parable and the Pharisee and the tax collector. It's paradoxical, I know. It's counterintuitive, I know. But the person who left justified was the tax collector. Why? Because it wasn't based on his own merits. It was based on his repentance and his trust in Christ. You know, one of the examples I give of this, and this is maybe one that hits home to me. Ever heard a sermon in your church? And when the sermon's over, you look across the church and you see someone sitting over the pew over there and you think to yourself, I'm really glad they were here today. They needed to hear that sermon. Ever do that? Everyone's thinking, ouch, right? Now, let's be honest. Sometimes people over there do need to hear that sermon, right? But if that's your MO, if that's your operating procedure, is all those other people need to hear that sermon. And the implication, of course, even though you wouldn't say this out loud, the implication being, I'm actually all right. I don't need to hear that sermon. Paul's like, well, you're falling into that very camp I'm going after here. You're one of those religious people that's convinced that I'm in special standing with God based on my own goodness. And God's law really applies to other people. You know, one of the dangers about religious people is we like the fact that God judges sin, right? Remember what the Israelites do to those Gentiles out there? Go, God, go get them. Yeah, we're tired of that. But here's the thing about religious people. They're glad when God judges sin, as long as it's not what? Their own. Or the little narrow pocket of sin you've carved out for yourself. Some sins God can judge, just not mine. Now, when you hear that, you think, this is just insane. Who would talk like this? Who thinks like this? The honest truth is we think like this. Our culture thinks like this. Southern American Christianity thinks like this. And first century Jews in Paul's own day thought like this. And religious people generally speak like this. So when you realize Paul is trying to make sure that everyone stands on level ground under the cross and everybody needs Jesus equally, he's working hard to do it here, right? It's easy to go after the Gentiles. That was chapter one. You're like, yeah, of course, you can make your laundry list of things they do there. That's an easy target, low-hanging fruit. But Paul says, I'm not done, because the real thing that I want you to see is it's not just those easy targets out there. All of us are in the same need for the gospel. We all need Christ equally. So here's the thing before we leave Roman numeral 2. It's just a scary reality. You have to recognize this, that some people think they're okay with God when they aren't. It's just the bottom line. Some people think they're doing just fine with God, and they really aren't. And we need to not only realize that when we share the gospel with other people, but we need to ask that hard question about ourselves. Have I convinced myself that I'm going to be just fine on Judgment Day because of all these little things, when I realize that that is just a fool's errand? I'm just tricking myself. Paul says, don't trick yourself. Don't be like the Pharisee in the temple. Realize that being outwardly religious isn't going to cut it. It's not going to get it done. Yep?
I just can't get Ruth's comment out of my mind. And I think part of what we're dealing with culturally today is what you just said about the whole American. We are a Christian nation. That part of the world that we're dealing with exactly looks at us for that. And because as a nation and as a people, we have grown so far short of God's true standard for righteousness, they in their, I'm just saying the word, Islamic belief system feel like they're doing God's work to judge us. Now, we all know that's wrong, but I really do believe part of God's judging and giving our attention
Christian, and not just us, France, England, anything that's West.
Sure, sure. Yeah, it's interesting. When you look at the decline of America, particularly in the last 5, 10, 15 years, on one level, it's clearly bad news. Right, let's be honest. Of course it's bad news. Who wants to see a decline of a nation? But on the flip side, there's a silver lining to it, and that is the illusion that being American makes you a Christian is going to disappear. Once you realize the nation is swinging the direction it's going, then the idea that just kind of hanging out in America makes you a Christian is gone, because now Christianity is seen as just the absolute enemy of everything. And the only people who are really going to be standing up for Christ are people who really are Christians. So this sort of pseudo-social Christian or fake Christian or convenient Christian, that whole category is going away. And that's not a bad thing. This is why the church truthfully thrives under persecution, because the church is purified by persecution. And you can't just hang out on the wings and say, "Ah, I'm a Christian." No one's going to do that in 5 years. Because in 5 years, if you say, "Yeah, I'm a Christian," you know, pile on. It's already happening now. So people are going to say, "Maybe I'm not a Christian," right? They don't want anything to do with that. And so there's going to be a situation where that changing scenario actually has a backdoor blessing to it. So we can certainly recognize that. Now, Paul's point here then, in Roman numeral 2, is some people think they're okay, particularly religious people, when they're not. Now, Roman numeral 3, he sort of finishes his case. In Roman numeral 3, he says, "Let me tell you why religious people are justly under God's judgment." So we know they're self-deceived in one sense. That was Roman numeral 2. Roman numeral 3 is Paul's going to say, but let me tell you why even people who are outwardly moral on the surface still are in danger of God's judgment on the final day. Here's where he sort of unpacks three different points. Let's just look at them one at a time. First, point A at the bottom of your page there. First thing you have to make sure is the reason religious people are going to be held accountable is because they actually know what's right and wrong. Look at point A. Religious people clearly know the difference between right and wrong. Here's the thing is that, remember what Paul did in Romans 1 with the Gentile out there? Someone could give them an out by saying, "Oh, the Gentiles out there don't really understand right and wrong, don't really know good and bad." And Paul says, now they do from the created world, right? And so they're without excuse. Could a religious person now claim, "I don't know the difference between right and wrong"? And here's the irony is, of course, they've just condemned themselves, right? Because if you're a religious person, you're out there condemning all these sins, you can't then go to God judgment today and say, "Oh, I don't know what's sinful and what's not." You are in the worst position as a religious person because you just got finished condemning everybody else. And what's that mean? That means you really do know what's right and wrong. Therefore, there's certainly no excuse for a religious person. You absolutely know what's right and wrong. And in Paul's mind, that's the Israelite. The Israelites have no excuse. They can never go to God and say, "Well, we didn't know. We had no idea." God would look at them and say, "What do you mean you had no idea? You spent all your time condemning all these Gentile nations for breaking the law. Of course you knew." In fact, Paul is so clear on this, he even uses the phrase, "without excuse again," which is an echo of chapter 1. Notice it there in verse 1. "Therefore, you have no excuse, O man, every one of you who judges." Notice what Paul's doing here. He's drawing the same language from chapter 1 and saying, just like the Gentiles had no excuse because they knew what was right and wrong, you religious people are doubly in trouble here, because you can't say that you can get off the hook because you didn't know, because if anybody knows, you know. Okay, so that's point one Paul wants to make. Why is it that religious people are going to be liable to judgment? Number one is they know the difference between right and wrong. Flip the page over. Paul is certainly not done. He has a second thing, and this is really the big one here. The second real big point is that religious people often practice the very things they condemn. Ouch. Here's the thing, is that while often the Israelites are busy condemning the Gentiles for all their awfulness out in the world, Paul says, you want to know something? Take a look around. You, religious people, you Israelites, my fellow Jews, says Paul, you guys are doing many of the same things that they're doing. Look where Paul says this in the passage, particularly verse 3. "Do you suppose, O man, you who judge those who practice such things, and yet do them yourself, that you will escape the judgment of God?" Now here's the height. There's a word for this. We all know what the word is. It's the H word. What's Paul describing here? Hypocrisy, right? You awful people who do X, God should judge you. Secretly, I do X, but I'm going to be okay. Think how crazy that sounds. Paul says, no, you won't be okay. And no, I know the judge. No, actually, that's not the way the judge works. Doesn't matter if you know him. If you practice the same things that they're doing, don't you realize you're under the same judgment? It's just logic. You're doing the same things, same judgment. So here's a stunning thing, is that Paul is basically looking at his fellow Jews, whom he loves very much as a fellow Israelite, and says, look, many of these same sins you are practicing. Now, when you look back at Romans 1, that's a scary list, right? But you know, when you think about the history of Israel, if you've read much of the Old Testament, you know this. The history of Israel is not a very pretty picture, right? Let's think about it for a moment. What are some of the sins that Israel kept falling into throughout its history, that many of which would have still been around in the first century? Who can think of some? What's that?
Idolatry.
Here's an amazing fact. Israel was committing idolatry. Remember Paul's point from Romans 1 is all about idolatry. And Israel was like, well, we believe in a monotheistic God. We're the only God. We're not going to commit idolatry. Not true. For generations, Israel had done exactly that thing. They'd pulled these gods away from all these other nations they had contact with, and they began to worship them. And God was furious about it, but they did it. So idolatry was a real problem even in Israel. Now, taking that just to the church today, Christians sometimes struggle with idolatry. Not little wooden gods necessarily, but several things. We talked about that in the prior class. So idolatry would be one thing that Israel historically has struggled with. Who else can think of other Old Testament examples of things that Israel struggled with? Yep. Ah, this was a big one, right? God would go after Israel for these sins, and they would just scoff at God, wave the hand and say, well, I'm not interested in you, God. And the hardness of Israel's heart was amazing. They didn't have anything to do with the true God. They had their religiosity, sure, but there was a hardness of heart there that Paul brings up, actually, in a minute in verse 5. What else? Yep. Yes. Yes. You think that the sexual sins are only out there? Paul says, read your Bibles, right? Half of what the Bible's talking about with all the idolatry that Israel's involved in have this corollary sexual sin associated with it. You want a really scary example of how far Israel fell at some point? Go back and read the book of Judges. The very last line in the book of Judges is that everyone's just doing what was right in their own eyes. Sounds like America, right? And it's amazing how far things went down in Israel. Now, we don't have time to sort of take a historical look at what was going on in the first century, but here's the reality, is that many of these sins were still going on in Israel. And Paul's saying, now let me get this straight. You're doing the same thing you're condemning, and you're glad God's judging them, but you think somehow that's not applying to you? That just doesn't work. Now notice the second little subpoint under B. It's not just that they did these things. They would never repent of them. This is Paul's real indictment. You know, Paul realizes that people are sinners, they're going to sin. He says, you know, the thing that marks a believer isn't sinlessness. The thing that marks a believer is repentance, okay? Now, we do want progress in holiness, so we'll see in a moment that one of the things that marks a believer is a distinct holiness, but Paul is saying one of the core things, though, that marks believers is that you just repent of the sins when you commit them, genuinely, and stop them. Look at verse 5 there and see how Paul describes this. He describes his fellow Israelites as pretty stiff words. But because of your hard and impenitent heart, impenitent. Now, let's be honest. We don't go around saying that word much today, right? Impenitent is like one of those religious words, holy words, right? But basically, it just means unrepentant, right? You sin, and you sin boldly. You sin consistently. You sin regularly. And you say, and that's just the way it is, God, and you don't repent of it. That's a hard, stubborn heart. And Paul's saying, you Israelites, you're busy condemning the Gentiles out there. Look at yourselves. You're going to be in serious danger of God's judgment. So what is point B's point here? Point B is, look, one of the reasons you guys are in danger is not because you know what's right. That's one reason. But secondly, because you're actually doing the same things, right? Your logic's messed up. If you're doing the same things, the same judgment's going to come on you. Now, before we leave that, though, one key clarification here. Notice my little bullet points at the bottom. People get hung up on this, and this is why I want to mention it here. The key clarification on point B is simply this. When Paul condemns those who judge, he is not saying that it's wrong for us to condemn sin. This is a classic misunderstanding of biblical text that people misunderstand here and in the Sermon on the Mount and other places. They think when God says don't judge, they think that means I can never say something's wrong. By the way, that's not what it means, okay? For one obvious reason is that we're actually called to call out sin in various places in Scripture. What is Paul getting at there? Notice my second line. Instead, Paul's saying that it's wrong to think you'll be saved simply by judging other people's sins when you have your own. In other words, what he's condemning here is a self-righteous attitude, right, that I'm different. I can judge other people's sins, but I don't have to worry about my own, which is exactly what Israel was doing. That kind of, I'm going to judge yours but not worry about my own, that's what Paul's condemning. He's not ever saying that you can't tell someone to stop sinning or that you can't tell someone that they're wrong for sinning. We're called to do that, particularly in the church. People in the church are off in rampant sin. particularly the pastors and elders, need to come to that person and say, you got to stop doing that, right? That's wrong to do. That's not being judgmental. What Paul's talking about here is judging in a way that you think you're exempt from the very things that you're judging other people for. Now, that leads us to point C, which is the real kicker, and we've been leading up to this thus far, and that is the real reason that Israel, and for that matter, any religious person won't escape this, is because of the way God judges. God does not believe in the buddy system when it comes to judging, right? It's not the old boys network where, hey, we're pals, we went to college together, I'm going to take it easy on you, right? Or you got a special relationship with me, and those people don't know me, well, they're in trouble, right? Kind of like you get a traffic ticket, and I remember one time I was driving to the beach, this is years ago, and I got a ticket to the beach, and on the way to the beach, so we're at the beach a week, and I come home, what do you think's in my mailbox? The lawyer over here, Tony's like, I know how this works. I had 17 letters from lawyers that within the 1 week I was at the beach, they had emailed me all these letters saying, hey, I can help you get out of the ticket. So I'm like, good gracious, what am I going to do? I got to go through all these letters and figure out how to get out of this ticket. Of course, my wife's over there going, you deserve this, you know, because I drive too fast. And so I'm going through all the tickets. And finally I said, well, I guess I should call some of these people. So I start calling them and try to get a feel. That's a tricky thing, trying to fill out a lawyer on the phone. Good luck with that. But this one guy says, I can get you off the ticket. I was like, really? How can you get me off the ticket? And he goes, I know the judge. We've known each other for 30 years. We went to college together. I was like, I'm going with this guy, right? And I did. And he got me off the ticket, right? Here's the thing, though. We think that's how it works with God. You know, whether I should have gotten out of that ticket's another question. I'll leave that for you to think about another point. There's flaws in our justice system. Maybe I took advantage of those flaws. We won't judge. Thank you. Because when you get a ticket, you'll probably do the same thing, right? All this is leading up to my point, though, which is simply that if you think God works that way, says Paul, think again. Because this is the way God works. God looks at you in the courtroom and says, I don't have this special backdoor relation with you. Why? Because I'm judging purely on the evidence. Okay? It's a fact-based judgment. And you want to know something? God has all the facts. He has them all. There's nothing hidden. There's nothing that can be tricked. You can't say, you can't try to bribe him. You can't try to sort of work a deal. You can't assume he doesn't have all the information. God knows everything. And he judges purely on the basis of what you've done. Notice the way I phrased point C there. God shows no partiality when he judges. Look at the very last verse of your passage. This is a scary verse, but it's a kind of scary verse that's the good kind because it ought to jolt us out of our lackadaisical attitudes. Look what it says, very simple, short verse. For God shows no partiality. So what's God going to use as the determining factor when he judges us? He's going to judge us based on the fruit in our lives. Look at verse 6. He will render each one according to his works. Now, I know that when you read that, you're thinking, whoa, hit the brakes. Did Paul just say we're saved by works? No, not at all. I make a little note here to say this is not Paul's point. Paul's not trying to make a whole letter about how we're saved by grace and then suddenly lose his mind in chapter 2 and say we're saved by works. That'd be odd, wouldn't it? What's Paul doing here? He's talking about fruit. When God judges us, he will look at the collective fruit in our lives, the collective behavior in our lives, and that will be the evidence by which he determines what's in our heart. Look what I've written there. When Paul says God judges a person according to his works, he does not mean we are saved by works. Instead, God judges a person according to his works because his works reveal who he really is. Works reveal whether a person is a follower of Christ or a follower of self. Paul is nailing the hypocrisy thing to the wall here. Here's his point. It's not enough just to be religious. It's not enough just to claim you're a follower of God. It's not just enough to condemn others. It's not just enough to talk the talk. When God looks at you in the judgment seat, he wants to see if your faith is real. And his gauge is the fruit in your life. You're not saved by your fruit, but your fruit, your good works, are evidence about whether you were playing for real, whether you were really a follower of Christ, whether your heart was really in it, or whether you were a fake religious outward person. So here's the reality, and it's simply this, is that God's judgment on the final day is a reality. Paul makes it clear. All of us, everybody, all over the place, Jew and Gentile, Southern Christian, everybody, will all stand before the judgment seat of Christ, and it's a purely impartial, fact-based rendering. He looks at the fruit of your life and says, is this evidence that this person had a real heart that followed me, or are these fruits evidence that this person was unrepentant and going their own way? This means that what we do, our behavior, our works really do matter. Paul wants you to see this today. His point isn't that they save you. It's not that God gets to heaven and weighs your works and says, well, if you did more good than bad, I'll let you in heaven. That's not what Paul's saying here. He's saying that your works are evidence of whether you really have a heart that loves God or not. It's fruit. So here's a test for you today. It's a very good test for all of us to put in ourselves at any point and ask ourselves, how's the fruit in my life? Is there a trend? Is there a characteristic of righteousness in my life that marks me out as one of God's people? Notice what I didn't say. I didn't say, is my life perfect? I didn't say, am I a perfect person? What I said was, is there a general trend towards holiness in my life, the kind of fruit that one day God can look at and say, there's evidence that that person really did trust me, really did follow me, really was someone who wasn't playing an outward game where they pretended to be religious but secretly were just sinning all the time. Paul is then going after hypocrisy here. So notice Paul, my little double asterisk there, Paul's big point. It's not enough to be religious. You can't just claim to follow God. The Jews did that. Your actions are evidence if your faith is genuine. And so Paul lists the fruit that's either good or bad here. Look at that list with me. And this is a list that should give us pause. Look at the fruit of positiveness, verse 7. To those who by patience in well-doing, or another way to say this in the Greek is persistence in doing good. Which I think actually some of the other translations, you may actually have some other translations that use this language, persistence in doing good is part of the fruit of a Christian. They're persistently doing good, not perfectly, but they're on that track. They seek glory and honor, not for themselves, but for God is the implication here, and immortality, which means they're looking towards eternity. What will their reward be? Their reward will be eternal life. And then Paul uses a very scary word in verse 8 to start off, but. That's not a word that always is good news, right? But for those who are self-seeking, that's one characteristic that's bad fruit. Do not obey the truth, bad fruit. But obey unrighteousness, bad fruit. There will be wrath and fury. Okay, here's a somber point I want you to make sure you take away today. And Paul gets at it here. Is it a final judgment is a reality? It's going to happen, and everybody in this room, including me, are all going to be there someday, and it's all going to be completely impartial. It's going to be real, and God's going to look at your life and all your fruit in your life, and he's going to say, is that the kind of fruit that marks one of my own, or is that the kind of fruit that marks someone who's not one of my own? It's not that the fruit saves you as if you worked your way to heaven, but the fruit reveals what's in your heart. So works really do matter. And for those of us who are Christians here and have been following Christ, we may get this idea that because I'm saved by grace, because I'm saved by what Christ has done, therefore, what I do is just totally irrelevant. It's just secondary. I can do whatever I want. I'm saved by grace, right? Actually, Paul blows that to smithereens later in his letter, but here he does it too by saying, look, actually your fruit matters. Why? Because your fruit tells you whether you're playing for real or whether you're just a fake. We all know people who are religious fakes. And Paul is saying, here's my point today. Don't be one of those people. If you're going to follow Christ, it's going to bear fruit, and that fruit is going to be the thing that God looks to on the day of judgment. So let me wrap this up here in terms of what Paul is saying in this chapter. Remember where we started. Paul's main point is you can't just look at what Paul says about the Gentiles out there and say, yeah, go Paul, go get them, right? Yay. And Paul says, hold on, I'm coming for you too, right? You're a religious person. You're like that Pharisee who walks into the temple and says, thank God, I'm not like other people. I give a tenth of all I get, and I'm a great guy. God, you're lucky to have me on your team. And Paul says, no, that's not the way that works. The only way that one can be saved, Paul says, is by repenting and trusting in Jesus Christ. And that will bear fruit in your life, and that fruit on the day of judgment will stand. It will stand because it's fruit not produced in unrighteousness or in haughtiness or in arrogance. It's fruit produced by Christ who lives in you and through you. That's the good news of this text that Paul eventually wants us to see. So there's a lot to discuss in discussion groups today. As you can imagine, you know, you're thinking every week, when are we going to get sort of a lighter lesson here, right? Well, that's coming. Maybe. Romans is a thick book. So as I said at the very beginning of this whole study, what did I say? Buckle your seatbelt, right? It's going to be a ride, and Paul's taking us on it. But it's a good ride, because at the end of the day, what do you see when you see your sin more greatly? You see the greatness and the glory of Christ who saved us, who loved us enough to even die for us. Let me pray for us, and then we'll jump into our discussion groups. Let's pray. Lord, you are gracious to us, Lord. You don't save us by what we do, but you are gracious because you saved us through what Christ has done. You loved us enough, even as sinners, to send your Son to die for us. What great news. Lord, today, help us not to be merely outward religious people who point the finger at others. But Lord, help us to realize that we too stand under your judgment, and then to look to Christ and him alone as our hope. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen.